No, it's supposed to be their summertime, too. So.
Oh, yeah. Hey. Well, take care.
I want to get in his luggage.
Do your turn.
Right.
Hey, Kurt, say hi.
Hi.
We're doing a video, man.
I know that I have to talk about details in my life, but I don't think I'm going to be any more open with my personal life in any other interview in the future. People don't deserve to know, really. I mean, it's none of their business what my personal life is like now. They don't need to know everything about me. Up until I was about 8 years old, I had an extremely happy childhood, a really good one. I had everything in focus. I knew exactly what I was going to do, and nothing could stop me. And I knew that I could do whatever I wanted because the world was really small. And things just happened to lay down before me with luck. There were no obstacles in my life at that time. I was such a nihilistic jerk half the time. I was so fucking sarcastic at times, and then at other times I'm so vulnerable and so sincere. And that's pretty much how every song comes out. It's like a mixture of both of them. And that's pretty much how most people my age are. They're sarcastic 1 minute and then caring the next.
I'm just as pissed off about the things that made me pissed off a few years ago.
And it's not necessarily personal things. It's rape and violence and...
Yeah. I'm pissed off about everything in general. And so all these songs are pretty much about my battle with things that piss me off, and that's just the whole theme of the whole album. With every album I do,
they all are basically saying the same thing. I mean, I have this conflict between good and evil and man and woman.
It's people doing evil things to other people for no reason, you know? I just want to beat the shit out of them. That's the bottom line.
There's nothing more embarrassing than a group of people walking up to you and shaking and clamoring and praising you like you're some kind of fucking god or something. It's embarrassing.
Bloody brilliant.
Well, what do you think about interviews?
Right.
It's a pretty
what
good
do
magazine.
I think?
Really
Did you
good.
Hear my reaction when he asked me if I wanted to do one?
Yeah.
I said fuck no.
Yeah.
I said heck
we were,
no.
We were...
Stand by. Five. 4, 3, 2
Hi, I'm Charles Barkley, host of the season premiere of Saturday Night Live with Nirvana. Look, Mom, your favorite, Nirvana.
Oh, yeah, all of you that love all things food. Dave, I have to tell you, Kurt hated you.
Really?
He's the most well-adjusted boy I've ever met. He's totally easy to get along with. Everyone loves him. He plays drums better than any drummer I've ever heard. I mean, he blows away John Bonham. If I had the choice of like bringing John Bonham back to life or to choose of any drummer of any band I can even think of, they wouldn't be better than Dave. He's great.
He's great. Yeah, he's the backbone of the band.
Dave was playing in the Washington D.C. band Scream when things fell apart. Dave explains.
In 1990, we were on tour, doing a tour of America. And we were halfway through the tour in Los Angeles.
Their tour made it as far as Los Angeles, and their bass player flew the coop.
We got stranded there. There wasn't really much to do. And I called my friend Buzz Osborne, who is a singer for the Melvins. We'd known each other for a while.
Mutual friend of Kurt and Chris.
Yeah. He's actually the one that introduced them to each other. And he ended up introducing me to the band. And he just said that... they were looking for a drummer and that they saw Screenplay in San Francisco and thought it was really good, blah, 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 no romantic story.
We were just blown away by the whole band, especially the drummer. The drummer was really good.
I called him up.
When he called up, we're like, yeah, man, come on up.
The strangest thing about it was moving up to the Northwest with no money and nothing. I mean, I'd still only have like a bag of clothes and I have drums. I bought a bed a couple months ago, so I have a room with this futon on the floor. But I mean, I don't have anything, so I didn't really have to move. And just, you know, moving up, leaving your best friends in the world.
Yeah, it was weirder for him, probably, because he's kind of homesick, you know?
I mean, I didn't know Chris or Kurt, and I ended up living on Kurt's couch for 8 months.
And just packed up his stuff and came to Washington State.
I had every misconception that everyone else had, you know?
Sure.
All I thought Seattle was like flannel shirts and blurry Charles Peterson photos, you know?
Living in this little Cracker Box hellhole of an apartment.
I'm quite a slob, as you can see.
If you had someone that you did not know come and move into your apartment, and you were sort of like, you felt this responsibility, like, okay, we must get along.
It was kind of hard for two people to live in this really small, you know, apartment with one bedroom and just garbage all over the floor. A lot of corn dog sticks laying around.
Whatever, like a month or two, we were out in the backyard shooting stuff with BB guns and breaking windows at the lottery building across the street. It was fun. It was great. That apartment was great.
It was nice because Dave turns out to be just as much of a slob as me.
I didn't talk about Nirvana for the first, you know, like 2 or 3 years of being a band, for lots of reasons. One, the biggest reason is that, you know, a good friend of mine died, and I didn't just want to go and talk about it to everybody because I was still trying to work that out on my own, you know. And
did you talk to your band about it? Like, could you guys, like,
well,
you have to be a friend, not just a bandmate at that point, right?
Yeah, we didn't talk about it all the time, but not like in a dark way, really. More like just telling me fun stories and anecdotes, and I would ask him about stuff because I was obviously a major fan and thought, you know, he was brilliant. So I would ask Dave a few questions here and there.
But it was also tough too because, you know, one of the things about starting this band was it was time to keep moving, you know. And after something like that happens, it's like you don't know how to recover from something like that. There's no textbook to help you through something as tragic and horrific as that. So,
and it's public.
Well, yeah, and so it was just time to keep playing, you know. I'd been in bands a long time before that. I wasn't ready to give up music, you know. Mm-hmm. And there were times where I really felt like it. It was hard to listen to music because I was
kind of passive aggressive in a way, you know. We don't confront one another if we're pissed off at each other. We just let the other person know that we're bothered by something that they've said, and then just forget about it, you know. It's really the only way to work with somebody. None of us have really that aggressive of personalities, really. We're all pretty much the same kind of people, you know. So mm-hmm. we started as friends, and I can't see anything getting in the way to stop us from being friends. I really don't care what anyone thinks about my past drug use. I can put the blame on that kind of influence, but it's a mixture of, you know, rock and roll in general, you know, the Keith Richards thing and Iggy Pop and all those other people that did drugs. I just thought it was just one of those things that you do, you know, to relieve the pain. But, you know, as I expected, before I started doing heroin, I realized that I knew it at the beginning that it would become just as boring as marijuana does, you know. Like all drugs, after a few months, it's just as boring as, you know, breathing air, you know. So I just don't want to try. I've always lied about it because I didn't want to influence anybody, you know. I didn't want anyone to even consider the thought of doing drugs because it's really stupid. When we play live, we lack a lot of things because I have to concentrate on so many different areas at once, you know. I've always lacked in any kind of participation or any kind of feelings with the audience, you know what I'm saying? Like, I can never really, because I'm concentrated on my guitar and I have to remember the lyrics and I have to remember to push these little buttons down on my fuzz pedals and stuff, and I have to sing and all this stuff, it just confuses me. I can't chew gum and walk at the same time, so I'm expected to do like six things at once, and so just adding another guitar player is totally a relief. It just really helps. It's great. And we got this guy Pat Smear, who's in the Germs. To tell you the truth, I would rather just quit my band and join Hole, you know. But only because when I have played music with them, there's a level of connection that's a little bit higher than with anyone else that I've ever played with. It's amazing. It's something that's totally satisfying for Courtney and I, but completely unrealistic because we're already so intertwined with each other, and you know, everyone doesn't even, most people don't even think of the band Nirvana anymore. They think of Kurt and Courtney, you know. And it's,
we weren't very happy with Chad's drumming, basically.
I mean, he has his own unique style, and it's appropriate for a lot of the songs that we wrote, but not for what we really wanted to do at the time. We just wanted to move into more of a pop world, you know, at the time, and it just, his style just didn't fit.
Well, the band started in 1987 in a small coastal town in Aberdeen, Washington.
I'd been playing guitar for about 3 years before I started a band. I couldn't find anyone in my hometown to play with, so I met Chris.
Have a little tiny taste. She thinks it's medicine.
I know she does.
Because it comes from the spoon, right? It's always the
now. That is good. There's no anything.
You got
that's
it
a
now.
Lot, Kurt. It's a lot.
Well, and you mentioned that Courtney came with that, those dresses, and she's recording right here. I mean, do you by any chance interfere with what she's doing in her work, or how much does one interferes with other works?
Yeah, we get in each other's way every once in a while.
Well, but...
It's like the core of personality and ego is like humans are social creatures, so I can't hear.
Come on, same thing is covering
your
ears. Oh! Are these the socks you got on the airplane?
Yeah, I've been wearing them ever since.
You want a wipe with this?
No, not my sock.
Because, I mean, he was a lyricist, and he definitely had a lot to offer with words, you know. His lyrics were really interesting, and he'd stay up at night for hours with a notebook, just writing and writing and writing and writing and writing. And not necessarily lyrics, just writing. And I think a lot of his lyrics came from those journals where he just sort of pick lines out of these, you know, play on words here and there. And he enjoyed writing a lot. I don't enjoy writing lyrics. Yeah, I mean, I played them tapes of stuff, and there are a few songs that Kurt liked a lot and wanted to turn into Nirvana songs. But for some reason, they just never did. The song Alone and Easy Target, that song, Kurt really liked that song a lot, and he liked the chorus a lot, and I think he wanted to make the chorus into something. And then there's a song called Exhausted that apparently, he actually never said to me, but he liked the song a lot. He just wanted to write his own lyrics to it, and I think he was afraid to ask me if we could do the song, but with his lyrics, which I would have said, shit, sure. Fine, that'd be great.
How come you are so nice? And you seem so comfortable with yourself. Something must have really happened in the last couple of years. Is it just falling in love?
No.
What happened?
I've always been a nice guy.
afraid to show it before. How's that?
Well, what? I don't know. You've never met me before.
I never met you before, but I know that other people who have had the opportunity to interview and you went, they said, oh, he hates doing interviews. He's not going to want to talk about anything. Well, and I said, well, you know, whatever. Who knows? And you're just like exactly the opposite of.
It just depends on what mood I'm in, really. Yeah, I'm kind of a moody person. And
so here we have your typical American hard rock band setting up for a day's practice.
Blew my ears out. This goes into your guitar.
Hey.
Punk rock to a child with adrenaline problems is like a dream come true.
We haven't worked for 2 years. And I encourage anybody not to work.
Working can wait.
I say slack off,
working
because you're only going to be alive for 70 years if you're lucky, right? And we just contribute to this sick materialistic society, so slack off. Big deal. You know? Have fun.
Smoke pot.
Drink beer. Booze. Inhale. Take.
Get each other pregnant.
Yeah. No, don't get pregnant.
Reproduce.
Don't reproduce.
Senti sto rock and roll, io non ti ho sentito, un po' di energia, adesso ne parliamo sul serio, adesso
al college in America, che ci fai con il runner? I'm so sorry.
Un po' hai capito, poi sorry. Andiamo.
Ma do you know him?
I've never seen him before in my life.
Never? Che cosa?
Senti,
non ti conosce, non sai chi sei.
Forse andiamo,
regà, ma andiamo
che
è
meglio,
va. Give me some damage, some problem.
Forse andiamo.
Nirvana,
tu.
No,
adesso andiamo.
Tu devi stare al college in America. I'm sorry, I'm so sorry. Even though, I'm sorry.
Guarda che io mi occupo,
Ma che ti occupi?
Io mi occupo dai lavori, oggi pare, mi occupo, questo deve andare al gruppo.
Di Nirvana,
domani stamattina,
ma vieni qua! Che ne parliamo un attimo, ma vieni qua, ma dove vai? Cercatelo! Pubblicità!
Pubblicità! I said no before even asking you guys. That's because I'm the leader of the band.
You blew my...
Kurt had an amazing pop sensibility, an amazing essence in his persona that was so full of charisma and character, and you got drawn into his persona, and also his singing really drew you in. And there's very few artists that have that. It's something you can't really even define, but he definitely had it. First time I met the band, I thought that Kurt was incredibly weird because he was incredibly articulate, but also very quiet and sometimes shy and sometimes very moody.
I started playing the song, and all of a sudden the amp was just so overdriven, it started cutting out and it just died. And so instead of standing there going, duh, I thought I'd do the sensational bass toss. I've got some pretty good air before, so I threw it up there and I had some beers and stuff and made it a little nervous, and I caught it wrong. It just popped me on the head and just kind of fell down, and I just ran off stage, and Kurt didn't even know what happened, and I'm like walking off stage, he sees me and he kicks me in the ass as I walk off stage, of all things. And then he didn't know what happened. After he told me, he goes, I'm sorry I did that, I didn't know what happened.
You know, we're really passive aggressive people. We don't like to complain to each other very often, and that's probably why we survived.
We should go into therapy, all of us. Sit down with this therapist.
No way. We should just bitch about each other in articles, you know, separately.
Yeah, read the book.
Yeah. Read the book, I know, yeah.
I mean, if this isn't therapy, what is? He's sitting on a toilet in front of national TV. Christ, this is therapy. Okay,
we wanted to, for sure. I mean, we were determined about a year and a half ago, after getting off of
you know, the grueling tour that we had. And then we realized that because of the production costs and because we have to bring our own lights and our own PA and all that stuff, it costs a lot of money. If we were to just play like venues and clubs and stuff, we'd be totally in the hole, you know. We're not nearly as rich as everyone thinks we are. Because it used to be so much fun in clubs, reminiscing about the old days. But, you know, I used to be able to jump out in the audience, and then the audience would, like, carry me all the way to the back and, like roll around all the way to the back. And it was really fun. And it was like a celebration. Like, everyone's jumping, you know, throwing up in the air and everything. Yeah, like a beach ball at an arena rock concert. But these kids just, Some of them just don't understand that. They're not used to that. So is all they know how to do is to tear people apart.
I don't know. I just think our morale is at its best right now, you know? I couldn't be happier right now.
About a year and a half ago, I was completely fed up with the whole thing. I didn't want to be a rock star at all. It was freaking me out, yeah. But I had 2 years to recuperate.
Fighters moment in there is because two things happen tonight. This usually happens. Somebody holds up a Kurt t-shirt. I think it's a compliment.
You know, I don't need to see a picture of Kurt, asshole. And I'm gonna have you fucking removed if you keep throwing that up. I'm not Kurt. I have to live with this fucking shit and this ghost and this kid every day. Throwing that up is stupid and rude, and I'm gonna beat the fuck out of you. Do it again.
There's one song, Honey, it's obviously about Kurt, okay? Like, I've never written a song about Kurt, maybe Northern Star, but, like, that's it, you know? And Honey makes me cry. When we wrote it, it took us 12 days to write it because I kept crying. I couldn't sing it. So I don't need to see Kurt's face, three tears of Kurt. I don't think it would be mean, you know? But when people come up to me and say, I love Nirvana, I wasn't in Nirvana. However, I do own Nirvana with my daughter, and because of tax laws, I have to give the money to the sister, Kim Cobain, and Wendy Cobain. So I don't understand what I was saying is Dave makes $5 million a show. He doesn't need the money. His mother's a banker. His father's a stockbroker. And he's making $5 million a show. He's in the Foo Fighters, making a fortune. Why the fuck then does he have a Nirvana Inc. credit card and I don't? And last week he bought an Aston Martin on it. Okay? That's taking, do you know that my mother-in-law, my sister-in-law's homeless. She lives under the bridge that Kurt sang about. It pisses me off that my mother-in-law doesn't have a front door in the winter. Okay, her boiler doesn't work. And her fucking, she has black mold. And Dave bought an Aston Martin last week. Okay, so don't fucking tell me that the Foo Fighters, you can go like them all you want, but don't say you like them in front of me, or I will walk off stage and I will never come back. I don't care how much more popular they are. Because Dave knows that I know that he knows that I know that he fucking knows that I know, all right? So he didn't write one fucking note. He didn't even write the drum riff in Smells Like Teen Spirit. Kurt owns 100% of that publishing. Forget me, I make tons of money. My daughter, my mother-in-law, Kim Cobain, Wendy Cobain, and Brianne Cobain. That's what I care about. Okay? Do you understand? So fuck Dave. That's all. Great! We'll leave now. Fuck you!
Do you guys want to see Courtney back? Alright, then repeat after me after three. The Foo Fighters are gay. One, two, three!
Carry you listen to at home, but a guy takes money off my kid's table, fuck him.
Mysterious. So you can just like, because we just can't explain ourselves, we don't consciously think about our music, so we can't explain it. Therefore, interviews are worthless. Let's go.
All right. Bye.